Well, good morning, church, and welcome to our online service today. Sad that we can't be together in person, but just know that you are worshipping together with people all around our city who are acknowledging the one true creator and the one who can actually get us through all the ramifications of lockdowns and everything that's going on with COVID at the moment. So we're excited to be able to worship together, and I would encourage you that wherever you are, in whatever place you are, whether it be your lounge room or somewhere else, that you join in and actively engage in worship this morning. Don't just sit there and watch, don't be a spectator, but actually engage and let God hear the cries of your heart today. As we worship, we're going to sing together and ask God to open the eyes of our heart.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. See you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy.
Let's sing, open the eyes of my heart.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Won't you open the eyes of my heart? I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Won't you open the eyes of my heart? I want to see you, see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy. See you high and lifted up, shining.
Shining in the light of your glory. Pour out.
eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. 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 I want to see you.
Jesus, Jesus,
alive in us, oh Jesus, Jesus alive in us, oh Jesus, Jesus alive in us. Under your feet, you have conquered, you have conquered. Compares to this, what a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus. Didn't want heaven without us, so Jesus, you brought heaven down. Sin was great, your love was greater. What could separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is. And nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus. Yeah. Your name is wonderful. Your name is beautiful. Your name is glorious, oh Lord. Lift our voices now in worship of the one true God, the one true God. Death could not hold you, felt all before you, silence the voice of sin and grief. Heavens are roaring, praise all the glory, for you are raised to life. You have no rival, you have no equal, now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is a kingdom, yours is a glory, yours is the name of a humble name. What a powerful name it is. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is, nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. Death could not hold you, felt all before you, silence the boast of sin and grave. Heavens are roaring, praise all your glory, for you are raised to life again. You have no rival, you have no equal. Now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is a Yours is the kingdom. Yours is the glory. Yours is the name of our whole name. What a powerful name it is. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus.
Thank you, Lord, that you have indeed got the most powerful name. And it is because you are so incredibly powerful. I pray, Lord, that as we invest our time in this worship together, that you would remind us afresh of how powerful you are. How majestic you are, how wonderful you are, how beautiful you are, that we would know, no matter where we are, no matter what we're going through, that you are with us and you are greater than this storm. You are greater than anything that can come against us. Thank you for your power, your beauty, your wonder. Help us to see that with open eyes and to be able to hear your voice at all times. God, be alive in us this day and every day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Well, welcome. It's good to be with you this Sunday morning, and I hope that you have managed your week well. My name's Adam. I'm the lead pastor here at Real Life, and I'm coming to you from our kitchen. Like all of us, we've been locked down this week, but I chose the kitchen for this part of our service because in our household, probably like many of you, the kitchen's kind of like the heart of the house. It's where hospitality happens. And I know that this part of our service when we gather together is as much about hospitality. It's about helping us all to feel at home and to know what's going on in the family. And so, yeah, wherever you are, in your lounge room or your bedroom, or maybe you're even outside on a deck or in your backyard, I hope that you feel at home with us together here at Real Life. So welcome. Thanks for joining in on us. And if you're visiting with us from outside, you're streaming in to our church service today from further beyond, we want to say welcome to you as well. We're so delighted that you would choose to spend some time with us as we worship our amazing Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Just so you know that in a couple of minutes, we're going to give you an opportunity, to check in. And there'll be a button that in a few moments' time will appear in our stream that invites you to connect. We encourage you to click that to let us know that you were here. Follow the link through. And there's a little notes section that'll come up that'll give you an opportunity to share any prayer requests that you might have so that together as a church, we can be praying for you and for one another. Those prayer points are confidential though, so please rest assured that no one will contact you about those prayer points, no one other than a pastor or unless you request that someone do that. So I invite you, share your prayer points. We are in a season in the life of our church of a month to breathe. August, we've said, is a month to breathe. And our message series is focusing in on this idea that prayer to our spiritual life is like oxygen to our physical life, this idea of our need for this relationship with God. So I hope that you are taking time to breathe as we journey together through our time of worship this morning, and that as you share that you're with us and perhaps share some prayer points, that we together can breathe those in and out together as we bring them before the Lord. Also in a moment, you'll have an opportunity to do some giving online. If you don't give via other means, that you're welcome to give. If you're visiting with us for the first time, you are very welcome to give. Please don't feel obligated to give. But it is a way that we invest together into the work that God does in and through Real Life Christian Church. And so I want to mention that to you. It is a second Sunday of the month, which means that in the giving button that will appear in the stream, there will be an opportunity for you to be able to choose to not only do some regular giving, but also to do some mission-focused giving. And across the life of Real Life, As a church, we support a number of missions. We support Nick and Jesse Ellis in Power to Change. We support a work through the James O'Fraser Centre in Thailand. And the money that goes through our mission giving probably doesn't quite cover our combined commitment to missions together as a church, but you can rest assured that the money that you choose to give over and above your regular giving will actually resource mission beyond the life of our local congregation. So I want to commend that to you. In a moment, we're going to have a chance to do that. Before we do that, I just wanted to encourage you to be checking out our prayer prompts through this month to breathe. Every day via our Instagram and our Facebook page, and even you can find a link to where those feeds appear on our website if you don't have social media, if you don't use it, for daily prayer prompts to focus us in our time to breathe. I want to commend those to you as we take time to do that. So thank you for joining with us. Please know we're in this together. We're going to pause for a couple of minutes to give you an opportunity to do that, to follow those links. So I encourage you to do that. If you're at home, you might like to, you know, charge up your coffee again or whatever you'd like to do. We have the opportunity to do that at home. And in just a couple of minutes, we're going to come back and we're going to take some time to pray. Well, thanks for taking the time to fill out a Connect link and any giving that you've done. As I mentioned earlier, we're going to take some time to pray. So why don't you join with me as we do that? Heavenly Father, we come to you in a highly disrupted week. Just aware that for many of us, lockdown has created some challenge. And Lord, we want to come to you with an attitude to really breathe in prayer, to actually receive your presence. And even as we've worshiped you in song already, Lord, we thank you for the presence that we can know as we give you all of our attention. Lord, we do ask right now that with whatever turmoil or angst or challenge or stress or drain that we might have experienced as we spent time locked down this week, that you might now help us to find peace in you. That the reality of our place in your kingdom might give hope, that you might hold us steadfast together in your hands, and that we might feel a renewed sense of your grace, which is abundant and lavished upon us. Lord, as we pray, we think about schools and students that are impacted by this COVID outbreak. Lord, we think of those schools directly where there are students and staff who've contracted the COVID-19 virus. Lord, we pray for healing. We pray for protection on those communities in particular. We pray for your peace. Lord, would you guard those schools around the Brisbane area, out through Indooroopilly and in that whole region. But Lord, we know that the nature of this virus means that it is quite contagious and that every school has been impacted. And we particularly think of the schools in our region around us at Real Life. And we pray that you would likewise protect student cohorts. We pray that you'd protect their families and pray that you'd give wisdom to those who are giving leadership to those communities. And Lord, of course, we pray for our school, Calvary Christian College. Lord, we pray for our principal, Sherilyn Gostolo. We ask that you would give her wisdom and the whole executive team as they manage the incredible disruption of students learning online. And Lord, whatever that will look like moving forward as we eventually move towards the end of a lockdown, what it looks like for students to adjust to new normals. We pray that your peace and your kindness, your graciousness might be so abundant to the whole Calvary Christian College community. Lord, we just celebrate just the great giftedness and capacity that's being exercised in that space. And Lord, too, we want to take a moment to pray for our neighbours. And I just invite you now, while we're in this attitude of prayer, wherever you are, to think about the people that live immediately around you on your street. Why don't you just take time now to ask the Lord to bless your neighbours, to break into their world, to bring peace to those who might be anxious, to bring care to those who might feel lonely and isolated. Why don't you just speak their names before God right now, asking His presence to move and minister. Lord, we want to thank you that you hear these prayers. Lord, you are great. Lord, you're so great. It's your breath that we breathe. Lord, you are to us sustenance. You are life. You are love. And Lord, we want to continue to worship you, giving you all of our attention with this sense of adoration this morning. Great are you, Lord. Amen.
So as we worship again, take this opportunity to reflect in your heart on how great God is. Because He truly is amazing. He truly is beautiful and wonderful and powerful. And He's worthy of every bit of praise that we can bring Him. Give light, you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath, it's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise, pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. We pour out our praise to you only. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise, pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise.
So we pour out our praise to you. Only it's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. Pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you. Only great are you, Lord.
Jesus, I pray that you would remind us of your greatness. When we look at the wonder of your creation, as we look around at the people around about us who are made in your image, as we see everything that you have created and everything that you've done, and as we remind ourselves of the things which you've done in each of our lives, remind us of your greatness. You truly are great. We love you, Lord. We love you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Everybody said, amen. Well, we're going to invite Karen to come and speak for us today.
Well, here we are again, Real Life Christian Church, in a time and moment that none of us expected to be in. And as you can see, I'm recording this weekend's message from my home, and it's not necessarily daylight, it's actually dark. This is the things that we have to do to get ready for a worship service on the weekend. So it's my privilege to be part of bringing the word to you for this series, and I hope that you've taken the opportunity this week to watch the beginning message in our series for August, which is Breathe. I also hope you've taken the time to use the daily prompts that lead you in your prayer times and connection with God. The message last week, Pastor Claire set the foundation for our series as we explored prayer is the air we breathe, and prayer is an essential for spiritual living as breathing is for physical life. And prayer is equal parts inhaling and exhaling. We looked at the why we pray, that prayer is our response to an invitation into relationship with God. And we can pray, and we pray continually so that we will not lose heart. Then Claire left us with this question. If prayer is like breathing, how long can you hold your breath? I found this question caused me to stop in my tracks. This is so challenging. I asked myself, do I see prayer so critical and essential to my life? It is far more important than the air I breathe. I asked myself, what is God trying to say to me? Then I had a Facebook memory come up from 2015 where I posted something from my devotions that day which said, when we open up our heart to God in prayer, then we are aligning our life more and more with His. This series we have entered into for the month of August is no coincidence that it has occurred at a time when a respiratory virus, a breathing virus, is threatening our day-to-day living. That wearing masks has become normal to protect ourselves and those around us. And I don't know about you, but wearing masks, while I totally understand the necessity, they are definitely not my favorite. And if I can avoid wearing them, I do. But you know, as I've reflected and prepared for this week, I believe God is calling us and saying to us, find your new rhythm in the new normal of masks and changes to your everyday life. Find your new rhythm of spending time with me. Don't let the uncomfortable and the restrictions of this respiratory virus, this breathing virus, impact on your rhythm of breathing in me every day, both personally and also as a community. And I want you to keep that at the fore of your mind as I share what God's laid on my heart this morning. I don't know if you've ever had an experience like I've had. I can remember very clearly a revelation God showed me at a moment in time. Ask me when it occurred, the date, the time, the season, the year, and I can't remember a single thing. But ask me about the scripture verse, the revelation, and my response and feeling, it's still so clear. It has remained with me as though it was only yesterday. I remember reading Psalm 84, which starts like this. How lovely is your tabernacle, O Lord of hosts. My soul longs, yes, even faints for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh cry out for the living God. And as I continued to read the rest of the psalm, I came to verse 10, which says, for a day in your courts is better than a thousand. I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than dwell in the tents of wickedness. The Passion Translation says it like this, for just one day of intimacy with you is like a thousand days of joy filled into one, rolled into one. I'd rather stand at the threshold in front of the gate beautiful, ready to go in and worship my God, than to live my life without you in the most beautiful palace of the wicked. I remember saying, yes, that's it, God. I don't want anything else. I don't want anything less, because nothing else is worth it. Nothing this earth has to offer can ever come close to spending time in the presence of the Most High. This revelation was and still is so fresh, so real for me. As we focus on our second week in the series Breathe, this is my prayer that we all will receive a fresh revelation of this truth. Nothing, absolutely nothing, can compare to taking time in our everyday, taking time to breathe, to constantly take in a fresh breath of the Holy Spirit, to stand in the presence of our God and adore Him. Let's pray before I go on. Heavenly Father, I just pray that you open our hearts and our minds and our ears and our spirit to what you want to say to us this day. That in this moment and time, we will give over to you all, Lord, all what we've had go before us this week, everything. And Lord, we say we give you this time and this space to you. Lord, breathe your breath of your Holy Spirit in us as we hear your truth this day, in Jesus' name. Amen. As a young Christian, the what and how, which we will be sharing over the next 4 weeks, is a practical structure we can adopt for our prayer life. And I actually discovered this very early on in my Christian walk. I have used this prayer structure to guide me every day on how and what to pray, as I've spent time in my everyday rhythm of life to breathe in Him. Our first focus when we take time to breathe, take time to engage in a heavenly exchange with God, is to begin our prayer time with adoration and worship. Why should this be our first focus as we pray? Well, because that's what Jesus taught us. Jesus first and foremost teaches us that adoration and worship should be our first focus when we come before our Heavenly Father in prayer. He taught this at the beginning of the Lord's Prayer. Matthew 6, verse 9 says, in this manner, therefore, pray. That's Jesus speaking. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Jesus, first of all, says, Our Father. He establishes the relational bar here for us, that when we come before God in prayer, it's not distant. It's not from afar, but it's to be in close proximity to the one and only true God. He says it's about a personal intimacy with God as our Father. Through Jesus, He has made the way for us to have a personal and intimate connection with God, that we can come before Him as a child, His precious child, and engage in a loving exchange. And it's in this loving exchange we can call Him Father. Galatians 4:4-6 says this, But when the set time had fully come, God sent His Son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those under the law, that we might receive adoption to sonship. Because you are His sons, God sent the Spirit of His Son into our hearts, the Spirit who calls out, Abba, Father. Abba is an intimate expression Jesus used to connect with His Father. And He is saying, when we pray, this same kind of intimacy can be present. Because through the coming of Christ and the gift of the Holy Spirit, we too, as a child of God, can cry out from the depths of our being, Abba, Father. So there is an intimacy and connection as we say, Heavenly Father. Jesus then goes on to say in the next part of the sentence, Hallowed be your name. Now the Greek word, which is up on the screen now, I'm not going to pronounce, but the pronunciation is there, hagiadzoi, means to hallow, to set apart, to consecrate, to separate, to sanctify, make holy, reverence. So hallowed be your name can also be reverenced your name, or holy be your name, or blessed be your name, or set apart your name, or praised be your name, or adore be your name. It's about treating God, our Heavenly Father, as sacred and ultimate, to make Him your most ultimate concern. Crucial and important, so important you give Him the highest priority. This is hallowed be your name. Jesus is saying not only is intimacy central in your connection with the Heavenly Father, but so too is adoration and worship of your Heavenly Father, putting Him first, giving Him the highest honor and priority. And they come hand in hand. Jesus is saying there is a personal worship exchange which takes place when you come before the Father in prayer. It's a devotion that comes straight from the heart. Tim Keller, author and pastor, he describes this exchange and connection between an intimacy as Heavenly Father with the holiness and reverence of God, like a pendulum swinging, and the extremes grow higher and higher the more they get pushed either way. So the more you connect intimately with your Father, the more you stand in awe of His holiness and how great He is, the more your revelation of God and who He is, His holiness, His worth grows, the more your intimacy and connection with God deepens and increases. This is how our prayer time should begin and grow. The more our intimacy with God grows, so too does the revelation that our God we are connecting with is holy and to be revered above anything else, and vice versa. So the pendulum keeps swinging higher and higher the deeper we go either way. Now, when I think of intimacy with God and taking opportunity to breathe, to pray as Jesus calls us to with adoration and worship, The Psalms is a great place to start. There are so many rich examples of prayers of adoration and worship. And as Claire encouraged us last week, we can pray the scriptures. And the Psalms is a perfect way to begin our prayer time in adoration and worship. Look at Psalm 84, which I mentioned at the start. So in the remaining time, I want to share with you five characteristics which can be evident and should be evident when we take time to breathe through adoration and worship, when we hallow His name. Let's start at Psalm 68 and look at verses 34 to 35. And I'm going to use the Amplified Version for this. It says, "Ascribe strength to God. His majesty is over Israel and His strength is in the skies. Our God, You are awesome and profoundly majestic from Your sanctuary. The God of Israel gives strength and power to His people. Blessed be God." When we come before God and stand in His presence, we can't help but have an overwhelming sense of awe and wonder of our amazing God. If we think about it, all we need to do is look around us. Look what surrounds us. Countless signs of God's power in His creation. I don't know about you, but when I look at what God has created, some of the amazing places I've been to and experienced, when I look at the amazing galaxy that is revealed through the night skies, I am just left breathless at God's unlimited power and majesty and how much He cares for each one of us. It's admiration at its fullest. It's respect and wonder inspired by the sacred. Adoration and worship is taking the time to stand in awe of Him. Psalm 33:8 says, "Let all the earth fear the Lord. Let all the inhabitants of the world stand in awe of Him." Psalm 119 verse 161 says, "Princes persecute me without a cause, but my heart stands in awe of Your word." Our hallowed be Your name moment, the beginning of our prayer time, is about being filled with awe and wonder, inhaling His majesty and greatness. What's another characteristic that we should see in our adoration and worship? Well, it is to declare His worth. The beginning of our prayer time will have declarations of value and importance of God. Psalm 19 verse 1 says, "The heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament shows His handiwork." The firmament is the stretch out expanse of the sky that declares the glory of God. And Psalm 66 verses 16 to 17 say, "Come and hear, all you who hear God, and I will declare what He has done for my soul. I cried to Him with my mouth, and He was extolled with my tongue." Or other translations say, "And He was praised with my tongue." Speaking out and telling of His value, His place in our lives, His place above anything we can possibly have or imagine, His place above all the things of this world, all our worldly pleasures. He desires whatever praise we can give Him. He deserves it. And He deserves more than what we can give Him, far more than what we can possibly express in our humanness. It's about declaring, "He is the lover of my soul, my provider, my deliverer, my redeemer, savior, healer, truth, love, grace." The list could go on. When we have inhaled the awe and wonder of God and His majesty and power, our hallowed be Your name moment, the beginning of our prayer time, is also filled with declarations of His worth. This becomes our exhale moment. The third characteristic of spending time in adoration and worship is to openly worship, to openly regard with great respect and honor and devotion our God. Psalm 95:6 says, "Oh, come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker." Worship is to bow down as an act of submission or reverence, to make oneself low, bow oneself low at the feet of Jesus. It's showing respect to God in worship is about a humble posture in worship, reflecting an attitude, a humble attitude of the heart. It's about opening your heart to Him and His will. You know, this is exactly what Jesus did in the Garden of Gethsemane. He bowed in prayer. In an attitude of humility, his heart totally surrendered. He surrendered everything and said, "Not my will, but your will be done," in Luke 22:42. This was a real vulnerability and rawness of emotion in Jesus' prayer in the Garden of Gethsemane. And we go on to read in verse 44 where it says, "And being in agony, he prayed more earnestly. Then his sweat became like great drops of blood falling down to the ground." I don't know about you, but I can just picture a vulnerability and an openness of Jesus' heart before the Father. Even the psalmist pours out an emotional, heartfelt expression of adoration and worship at the start of Psalm 84, verses 1 to 2 is what I read earlier, but let's look at it again. "How lovely is your tabernacle, O Lord of hosts. My soul longs, yes, even faints for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh cry out for the living God." Our time with God in prayer is not meant to be cold, rigid, or emotionless. God wants us to be real. He wants us to express our love from the depths of our being. He wants us to lift up our hands in praise and worship Him. He wants us to come before Him with singing and dancing, to bring shouts of praise, bow down in humble surrender, to clap and be still, to play instruments and kneel before our God. And you can find all of these open expressions of worship throughout the Psalms, but also all throughout Scripture. To openly worship is when we have inhaled the awe and wonder of God, His majesty and power. When we've exhaled and declared His worth, then our response is open and unashamed worship of our God. Our "Hallowed be your name" moment, the beginning of our prayer time, is characterized by open and vulnerable worship. Okay, let's look at our fourth characteristic of adoration and worship, and it is to reverence Him. When we refer to reverence, it's often interchangeable with fear. Now, I don't know about you, but fear in many of our minds has a certain meaning, but that's not what God means here when you see the word fear or reverence interchanged. It's about a holiness, a respect for the one we worship. It's about understanding we are standing on holy ground and in the presence of the Most Holy One. It's about having a deeper revelation of His holiness, totally conscious of the expanse and enormity of His presence with us and in us, and acknowledging the sacredness of every thought and every moment. Psalm 89 verse 7 says, "God is greatly to be feared in the assembly of the saints and to be held in reverence by all those around Him." Psalm 5 verse 7 says, "But as for me, I will come into your house in the multitude of your mercy. In fear of you, I will worship towards your holy temple." Notice the common theme coming through all these characteristics of our "Hallowed be your name" moments. It's about making a priority of spending time in the presence of God, revering his holiness, profoundly adoring him with awe and respect. We read this very act of reverence in the book of Revelations, where the throne of God is surrounded by worship, constant worship, 24/7 worship. Revelations 4 verses 8 to 11 paint this picture, and it says, "The four living creatures, each having six wings, were full of eyes around and within. And they do not rest day or night, saying, 'Holy, holy, holy Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come.' Whenever the living creatures give glory and honor and thanks to him who sits on the throne, who lives forever and ever, the 24 elders fall down before him who sits on the throne and worship him who lives forever and ever and cast their crowns before the throne, saying, 'You are worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and by your will they exist and were created.'" Here we are given a glimpse of heavenly worship. The 24 elders reverentially acknowledging the one from whom all things flow, from whom all things and all blessings flow. The reverence, the holiness, the omnipotence and eternity of the Lamb of God, who is now seated on the throne. When we reverence him, it is like inhaling the awe and wonder of God, his majesty and power, exhaling and declaring his worth, expressing open and unashamed worship of our God, and then being captivated by the holiness of the one we adore and worship. Our hallowed be your name moments are to be filled with reverence. And number five and final characteristic of what it's like to give adoration and worship in our prayer time is to exalt the name of Jesus. Exalt is to elevate, to worship, to raise in rank and power. Psalm 130 verse 1 says, "I will extol you, O Lord, for you have lifted me up and have not let my foes rejoice over me." Psalm 99 verse 5 and then verse 9 says, "Exalt the Lord our God and worship at his footstool. He is holy. Exalt the Lord our God and worship at his holy hill. For the Lord our God is holy." And then Psalm 119 verse 28 says, "You are my God and I will praise you. You are my God and I will exalt you." To elevate and lift up the name of Jesus is when we say from the depths of our being, "God, with your help and in your name, I will seek to lift you higher than anything in my life. You will come first in my life, Lord, and nothing will come close to the priority I place on you and my relationship with you." This is to be our confession that Jesus is Lord of our life. Philippians 2, 9 to 11 says, "Therefore God also has highly exalted him and given him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of those in earth and of those on earth and of those under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father." Jesus has been given the highest honor. His lordship has been established, and everyone in earth and on heaven will bow to him. When we speak, we are to confess, acknowledge, and proclaim his lordship. It's about every area of our life bowing towards God. eventually it's God's intent, every heart and every knee and every cell and every atom will point towards the throne of God. But we have no control of this. We can't control that moment or time. We can't control when every knee will bow, when every atom and cell will bow to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. But we can control when our heart bows to the throne of God, exalting His name, the name of Jesus. Our hallowed be your name moments are to be filled with exaltation of the name of Jesus. Exalting the name of Jesus is evident when we inhale the awe and wonder of God, exhale and declare His worth, openly express our worship to God. Then we are captivated by the reverence and holiness of the One who now sits on the throne, carrying the name that is above every name, which compels us to first and foremost adore Him. Five characteristics which shape the beginning of our prayer times, our breath moments of adoration and worship, our hallowed be your name moments. Here they are. Stand in awe, declare His worth, openly worship, reverence Him, and exalt the name of Jesus. Can you imagine what it would be like if all of us could grasp afresh this revelation to adore Him? When we come before our Heavenly Father, when we take time to breathe in the breath of God in the midst of our daily rhythm, learning to breathe to a new, deeper rhythm that we have ever gone before and ever known, and truly declare, hallowed be your name. Can you really, truly imagine what that would be like? The throne of God surrounded by worship that surpasses anything we can imagine. I think we could potentially have a glimpse of heavenly worship on earth if we got this revelation. Imagine what our prayer times would be like. In 1999, a song was written by a relatively unknown artist, a member of a band called Mercy Me. This song was the catalyst which launched Mercy Me onto the world stage. This song has spoken to people all around the world and paints a picture of what it might be like to stand before the King of Kings and Lord of Lords in heaven, to be surrounded by the glory of God and imagining what it would be, what would be our response and how we might feel. I am one of the many who have heard this song over and over and over again and been touched to the very core of my being just by the sheer picture it paints of an encounter with Jesus. It resonates with the revelation I shared at the start of Psalm 84. I'm sure you've heard this song, but if you haven't, we're going to play it in a moment. This hallowed be your name moment expressed through this song is such a God-inspired vision of adoration and worship. But you know what I think is the most profound truth that can be found? It's in the children's book that was written 20 years after the song was written, which I want to read for us now. It's called I Can Only Imagine for Little Ones, A Friendship with Jesus Now and Forever. It says, the more I imagine, the more I wish I knew when we go to heaven, just what will we do? Would Jesus play with me? Would He like what I like? Would He race with a wagon or ride on a bike? Do the houses in heaven have big rooms and spaces? Did God think of me when he built all those places? I can only imagine what God thinks is fun. We could jump in the lake and soak in the sun. I bet heaven serves ice cream before lunch every day, and the scoops are ginormous like an ice cream bouquet. Why, maybe in heaven God loves to play ball. Everyone gets chosen. There's room for us all. Surely the music in heaven is grand. We'll sit round the fire and make our own band. What about animals? Does God have a pet? Does he like Lulu's, the greatest dog yet? When I get to heaven, can I sit on God's knee? We'll all cuddle up close and hear his story. We know you. We love you. We'll be there together. Each day we'll be happy in heaven forever. I'm sure of one thing that will always be true. I don't have to wait to spend time with you. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. I'm sure of one thing that will always be true. I don't have to wait to spend time with you. We don't have to wait to be in heaven to spend time with him. We don't have to wait to be in heaven to have this revelation of adoration and worship. Because we can stand before the Heavenly Father face to face. And we can say, I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. Let's listen to the song.
I can only imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I would do is forever worship you. I can only imagine, yeah. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Sing hallelujah. Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in all of
can only imagine when all I would do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine.
Well, I don't know what you felt as you listened to the song. It stirs deep within my soul every time I hear it. And I can see the picture of heaven, but I can also see the picture of worship here on earth. My prayer for us, as we take time to breathe through adoration and worship, when we inhale and exhale with hallowed be your name, we won't have to imagine. We won't have to imagine what it's like, because what we will truly experience is an unexplainable heavenly encounter here on earth. Because Jesus went on to say, may your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Let's pray. Lord, you know each and every person who is listening to, who has listened to this message. You know each and every person that has chosen to go online and click on the link and be part of it even after this Sunday. And so, Lord God, you know where each one of us sits in our worship of you, in our relationship with you, and in our prayer time. Lord, my deepest prayer this day is that for all of us, we have a fresh revelation of what it means to stand in awe of you and to worship you, to adore you, to give you the true adoration that you are worth. I pray, Lord, that our prayer times will go deeper and deeper in with you, that the air that we breathe in, your Holy Spirit breath, will take us deeper in a relationship with you. And as we do that, the awe and wonder of you will be revealed more and more. And that all we'll be able to do is just stand in awe and stare at you face to face and gaze upon your beauty. Lord, I pray that as we go out from this week, that every breath and bone in our body we'll give praise and declaration to you, that we will first and foremost place you at the highest place of everything that we do. Whether it's homeschooling, whether it's being with our family, whether it's being with friends, whether it's in isolation, lockdown, whatever it might be, Lord, no matter what we do, may we put you first. But most of all, I pray that in all of it, you will create space and time where we can have hallowed be your name moments every single day. Lord, may we go from this time and this place filled with a fresh revelation, a fresh breath of you. I pray this in your powerful name. Amen.